I'm better. Hold up. I'm back and I'm better. Yeah. I'm still alive cause he's sober. Yeah, turn my morning in the dance and I'm laughing. Telling everybody that he's sober. Hallelujah, hallelujah. The title of my message today will be called Relentless Love. Tell somebody, relentless love. Well, this is the month of being relentless, right? But it's relentless love. Hallelujah. Because Jesus had to be relentless in his pursuit for you and me. He had to be relentless in his love to go to the cross and give his life up just for us. Hallelujah. So that we might have the power, the ability, and the wherewithal to walk in the destiny that God has called us to. Amen. So I want y'all to know that as we begin to read this word, as we begin, I need y'all to take some notes. Amen. Bishop been asking y'all, bring your notepads, your pens, bring your Bibles back out. I know y'all have these phone apps, but I'm promised to tell you, ain't nothing like your Bible. Ain't nothing like making notes and highlighting the word of God. I got all, if you read this Bible, anybody read my Bible should be able to preach because I got notes and I got outlines. You just take this Bible and just preach from it. Amen. It's nothing like having the word of God with you. Amen. So get your pads out. If you don't have your pencil and paper, then take you some notes. Amen. But start journaling the word of God. I promise you one day you're going to need to go back to it and read it to encourage yourself. Amen. Listen. I'm so on fire today because God has been so good. Can you look down your row and tell somebody God has been so good? Find somebody else and tell them. I hope you're not sitting to somebody to act like they don't know it. If they act like they don't know it, kind of nudge them a little bit. Shake them, push them, I don't know, pinch them. But ask them, has God been good to you? Come on, ask your neighbor, has God been good to you? Now let us answer the question. Did you wake up this morning? 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 Then I rest my case. Come on and give him glory. God has been good. Oh, he's been good. This is so personal for me. Hallelujah. All right, let us jump in the word. I don't have much time. Hallelujah. For me, this is personal. This is one of the most favorite days of the year. On this day, we celebrate the most important day of the life of the believer. Today is the day Jesus took victory over death, hell, and the grave. Somebody ought to be shouting. Hallelujah. Maybe some of y'all don't really understand what resurrection is about. Some people think it's about Easter. Some people think it's about the bunny. Let me tell you, baby, the bunny ain't never did nothing for you. Can't do nothing for you. Won't do nothing for you. Okay? Let's just get that out the way. Okay? That's something man came up with. Hallelujah. They would consider that paganism, a pagan holiday. The bunny has nothing to do with it. I know we get the baskets and we give our kids a basket, want them to have the little candy and little eggs, but you should give them the basket with truth and understanding. I bought my kids baskets too, but I gave it to them like this. Let me explain. The bunny didn't die for you. This is something the world do, and I just wanted to give you a basket with some coloring books and some chocolate. But the reason that we go to church is not because it's Easter. It's because your king got up on today. And because he got up, you go grow up with all power. You go walk in authority. You go walk in healing and deliverance because of Jesus, not the bunny. Come on and give him praise. You know, and the world do stuff so crazy to me because I never understood why they give us bunnies laying eggs. Can anybody answer that? I've never seen a bunny lay an egg. Amen. I tell you, if one of y'all can get a bunny to lay an egg, you'll be a million billionaire overnight, though. Hallelujah. So I want to be clear. This don't have anything to do with the bunny, but teach your children truth. Amen.
Even for Christmas, I taught and Bishop taught, we taught our children truth. Yes, we celebrated, we bought gifts, but we understood and taught our children at an early age. Somebody say early.
Early.
I got babies in here. They're in the back. Okay. There's a few. Okay. I don't know what y'all teaching them, but I have to teach truth. There's no Santa Claus. Come on, somebody, and say amen. Let me tell y'all why we taught our children this. There's no way in the world. Somebody say in the world. I'm going to be working hard. I used to do overtime. I used to do hair at 12 o'clock midnight. Bishop used to be running, hustling all week, all month, all year so we can get these gifts, pay all these bills off, and I'm going to give the credit to a man I don't even know. No, the credit go to the man that made it possible for us to get up, go make the money, go get the donuts, go get the bread, go buy the toys. We gave credit to where credit was due, and his name is Jesus. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. How we celebrating his birthday and giving it to somebody else? Don't make no sense. Somebody say amen. Okay, back to resurrection. That was for free. Jesus is the proof depiction that there is life after death. Somebody say amen. We see him as a great I am, whose name is above all names. We see him as the Lamb of God who was lifted up on a cross for our sins and our salvation. But the most profound truth about Jesus Christ is that he is the resurrection and the life. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
What you believe about the resurrection of Jesus Christ is so imperative, it's so important that it will determine the outcome of your eternal soul. So in other words, people of God, how many of y'all in here plan on going to heaven? How many of you want to go? Because I saw some didn't raise their hand. So I said, maybe they don't want to go. Maybe they never heard about it. You know, I don't know. But there's two places after death. It's either heaven or hell. And if you plan on visiting heaven, living in heaven, being in eternity with your family, with your husband, your wife, your children, your mother, whoever, you're going to have to believe in the resurrection. Without believing in the resurrection, you won't see heaven. Come on, somebody, and say amen. You must believe that Jesus died. For how many days? 3. And he got up on what? The 3rd day. And when he got up with what? All power. Come on and give God glory. So as a believer, you must believe that the resurrection and believe of the resurrection because it will determine your outcome for eternal life and your eternal soul. I humbly ask that you listen to this message today very carefully. Please allow the great truth about Jesus Christ as the resurrection and the life to speak into your hearts. I want to give you an understanding of what the word resurrection means. The rising of Christ from the dead. Now, this was in the Webster Dictionary. And I was shocked that the Webster Dictionary, I didn't get this out of like the Vines or the Bible Dictionary. I went to Webster to see what they had to say. And it said the rising of Christ from the dead, or the act of causing something that had ended or been forgotten or lost to exist again. To be used again. How many of y'all feel like maybe y'all lost something on this journey? How many of y'all feel like sometimes in life, I don't know if God see me, if I'm existing, if I'm on the right path, if I'm on my right journey? Well, I come to give somebody some hope this morning and tell you that because Jesus lives, you can live too. And I'm talking about with power in Jesus' name. The resurrection represents everything that is dead and negative in our lives that has been canceled. The resurrection cancels out every negative word, every negative deed. It cancels out every negative thought. It cancels out every negative assignment that the enemy has assigned to your life. Somebody need to be excited. Hallelujah. I'm going somewhere. I'm telling you. What does the resurrection mean to you? That's a personal question. What does the resurrection mean to you today as a believer, as a follower of Jesus Christ? It means to me a do-over. God asked me, what does it mean to you, princess? And I said, it means to me a do-over. It means to me new beginnings, a fresh start. Meaning that if I made a mistake, if I missed it, God is going to give me a fresh start because of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. There's some people believing God for a fresh start. I know I'm one of them. Hallelujah. Anyone that has received Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, I come to give you some exciting news. You have a fresh start and a new beginning as of right now today. Some of us don't realize this. Some of us don't even know this. But I come to tell you that because Jesus went to the cross, because he went to the grave, because he got up on the third day, baby, you got power too. Come on, tell somebody, I got power too. I have power too. Why? Because God gave it to Jesus and Jesus turned around and gave it to the church. Come on and celebrate him. Come on and celebrate his name. Hallelujah. The Bible said, matter of fact, Jesus said, these things, these miracles, these gifts I walk in, these signs and these wonders that you see me do. God turned around and said, not only can I do them, but he said, you will do them too. And greater. Come on, somebody say greater. In Jesus' name. God also gave you redemption because of Jesus Christ and because of the cross. Let me give you the definition of redemption. The action of saving or being saved from sin. Hallelujah. Wait a minute. Somebody's trying to explain to me that because Jesus died and because he rose on the third day, I've been saved from sin. You've been saved from sin. So, Pastor, what are you trying to say? I'm not saying that you will never make a mistake. I'm not saying you won't find yourself in sin. But what I am saying is that you've already been forgiven. You already been forgiven. We gonna hit on that in a minute. The action of saving or being saved from sin, error, or evil. The action of regaining or gaining possession of something in exchange for payment or clearing a debt. I want you to know, church, that we had a debt that we could not pay. Hallelujah. We had a debt. Anybody ever had a debt and you felt like, how am I going to get out of this? How will I get this behind me? And all of a sudden you get debt cancellation. All of a sudden the government forgives something. All of a sudden God comes through for you. Why? Because of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I have some believers here with us today in this sanctuary. They had major debts. I'm talking about owing school loans. I'm talking about $50,000, $100,000, $200,000. And God supernaturally, how much, Bishop? $300,000. And God supernaturally wiped away their debt. Y'all better praise him. Y'all better give him glory. Talking about his relentless love on today. Redemption. Freedom from guilt or blame for having done something wrong. How many of y'all can attest to that today? How many of us done found ourselves doing the wrong thing at the wrong time? But thank God for Jesus Christ that I've been forgiven and he came to redeem my life. Come on, somebody, and say amen. Lord, we thank you for relentless love towards us on today. We thank you, Father, that you were so mindful of us that you sent Jesus Christ. Amen. I'm ready for some word. Y'all ready for the word? Oh, I'm ready for some word because God is going to bust this word up in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's look at our first scripture. We're going over to John chapter 3, verse 16. And I have Minister Elect, Lenny will be reading, assisting me this morning. Amen. Amen. All right, man to God, let's flow.
For this is how God loved the world. He gave his one and only son, so that everyone who believes in him would not perish, but have eternal life.
Go ahead, keep reading it.
God sent his son into the world, not to judge the world, but to save the world through him.
All right, let me tell y'all something. The first thing God did to show his relentless love is he gave. The first thing he did is that he gave. Hallelujah. So I want to tell some of y'all that when you tell somebody or you want to say you love somebody, the first thing you should do is give. Whether that's of yourself, whether that's of your talent, whether that's of your treasure. God was an example to us. Amen. I believe he put this in scripture so we can have an understanding of when we say we love someone, when we say we love something, when we say we love somebody, that means there's a selfless act on our part. We give and sacrifice of ourselves just like we seen the Father. Say amen. Amen. So God, we thank you today for your giving of Jesus. Amen. Let's go to Mark chapter 15, verse 24 through 32. God has some good word. I'm telling you, pay attention in Jesus' name. Come on, let's read.
Then the soldiers nailed him to the cross.
Uh-huh.
They divided his clothes and threw dice to decide who would get each piece. It was 9 o'clock in the morning when they crucified him. A sign announced the charge against him. It read, "The King of the Jews." Two revolutionaries were crucified with him, one on his right and one on his left. The people passing by shouted abuse, shaking their heads in mockery. "Ha, look at you now," they yelled at him. "You said you were going to destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days."
It's something how the people were so blinded that they watched him do miracles. They watched him move in signs and wonders. Some of these same people saw Jesus stop funerals and raise the dead. Hallelujah. Do y'all understand that when a funeral was in possession, if Jesus showed up, he didn't pray. They just had to come back to life. Because anything around Jesus that appeared or seemed to be dead had to live again. Somebody say amen. So I've come to tell you on today that anything in your life today, anything that appears to be dead, anything that appears to be stagnated, anything that look like it's not working for you, anything that look like it's trying to dry up on your behalf, I need you to speak to it and decree and demand resurrection power hit you today in the mighty name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The people's eyes were blinded. And that's what we don't want to do in this day and time. We don't want to come to church and not recognize the living Christ. Hallelujah. We don't just want to come to church and say I danced, had a good time, go home and don't understand the power of the resurrection. Hallelujah. Keep reading.
"You said you were going to destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days. Well then, save yourself and come down from the cross."
Now I want y'all to see how they taunting at him. This is what they're doing. They're making a mockery of Jesus while he on the cross dying for them. You want to tell me that's not relentless love? Because if it had been me, I'd have said, "Get me down." I'm up here being tortured, beaten, suffering. Come on, keep it 100. And you walking by, throwing rocks, throwing shade, get me down from here. Let them see what it's going to be like without me dying. Let them see what they'll face without me going into the grave. Let them understand, God, who I really am. But Jesus didn't do that. Jesus loved you and me so much. He said, in spite of what they do, in spite of what they said, he said, "Father, forgive them." Come on, somebody say, "I've been forgiven." He said, "Father, forgive them because they know not what they do." Come on, somebody. You need to be excited about God forgiving you. Because I've done some things before I got the knowledge that I have today. And I thank God for his grace. I thank him for forgiving me because at that time I didn't know what I was doing. Somebody say amen. Have you ever prayed anything in your life and you wanted it like really, really bad? And it didn't happen? Like, have you prayed about something like, this is really, the next level I need to go to, or this is really the relationship I want, or this is really the girlfriend or the man I want to marry or the woman I want to marry. And then you get like 10 to 15 years down in time and life and living, and then you look back and be like, she was a fool. You be like, he was a nut. And you be like, God, I thank you for the no. God, I thank you for the no. God, I thank you for the no. I'm telling you, as I was studying, God was reminding me of some stuff I had prayed, but I didn't know no better. Anybody ever been there? But at the time, I thought, you know, I knew it all. I understood it all. I thought I was there. And last night, I had to say to the Lord, I just walked around my house and said, thank you for the no. Listen, sometimes the no is not a bad thing. Sometimes that no will save your life. You ever been trying to hang out, go somewhere? I remember I was trying to hang out and go somewhere, and my godmother said, no, you can't be over there. And I'm like, I'm only 16. Why? This is what everybody do. And you know what she told me? I ain't everybody's godmother. I'm yours. I thank God for the no. I remember being at a poker party, dice game, whatever you want to call it. And I went with one of my girlfriends. And we snuck and had went around here. It was like this house two, three blocks behind my godmother. And I had told them, I was like, I got to go through the back because she know everybody. Y'all got to let me in through the back. And they was like, is it that serious? It's that serious. Y'all don't know. Y'all don't know. So nobody told her. How about she was at home in prayer and the Lord told her that I was over at the dice game. Thinking I know something. So a knock came at the door about 30, 40 minutes after I was there. You heard a boom, boom. And my godmother knocked like the popo. Like it's 5-0 at the door. So everybody kind of got to scrambling, scared. And so they was like, I don't see no cars. So I heard these feet coming down the step, like boom, boom. I knew her walk because she walked with this authority, especially if she was mad. She was mad because she had already told me what? Don't go. Don't go. No. So I knew it. I started getting my coat, grabbed my book bag. I was like, Lord, she about to embarrass me. She came down them steps and I got embarrassed. And she told everybody at the party, she ain't like none of y'all. She gonna be some. God gonna use her. And I'm gonna see to it that she get to her destiny. And while she was talking, I was running up them steps. Hallelujah. I want to tell y'all something. Say, not 30 days. It was another card party, another dice game. So my girl who took me over there is like, you trying to sneak out? No, no. I was like, if God showed her that, he definitely going to show I'm back. No, I ain't going. I didn't go that night. They went in there and everybody was killed. Come on and give God glory for the no. For the no. What happened? They went in, somebody came in and robbed the dice game. Now, just think if I had been up in there. I thank God today for the no. Come on and praise him. It pays to listen to your spiritual leaders. It pays to listen to your spiritual godmother or godfathers or pastors or bishops who hear from God soundly. Hallelujah. It will save your life. Come on and bless them. I'm reminded of a young woman about 3 years ago or 4 years ago that came to this church and Bishop gave her a word right here on this altar, and a lot of y'all were here and remember the prophecy that went forth, and it was telling her and warning her not to get in the car with nobody for how many days? 30. How many of y'all was here? You was here. I want the people that wasn't here to see these hands. How many of y'all remember this word? Look around, because I don't want y'all to think we play games up in New Way. We don't. We hear from God in this house. And the word was, don't get in the car with nobody for how long?
30 days.
30 days. On day 29th, that young woman boyfriend called her and said, let's go get something to eat and I'm going to pick you up and bring you back home. She was getting dressed, and as she got dressed, she had a calendar on her door, she said, where she had been Xing off the days listening to the word of the man of God. And as she was Xing the days off, she looked at the calendar and realized she was on day 29. She called him back and said, you're not going to understand this, but I was told by a prophet not to ride with anybody for 30 days, and I'm on day 29. I can't go, but you can go get the food, make the run, and bring it back to me. I want y'all to know he never showed up. The run that he was picking her up to go make, they killed him. Never got out the car. Whoever he went or wherever, they walked straight up to the car and took his life. Do y'all think if she was in the car, they was going to say, excuse me, little girl, get out? They wasn't going to leave no witnesses. But she listened to the man of God. She had just had a son. I think he was 6 or 7 months old at the time. Because she listened to the instruction of the prophet, she's living today and she can raise her baby boy. Come on and give God glory. Because of God's love, because of his relentless love, he sent Jesus. And because he sent Jesus, Jesus made some prophets and released some prophets and some apostles and some teachers and some pastors in the earth. Come on, somebody, and give God glory. I'm talking about his relentless love today. Hallelujah. Come on, finish, Lenny.
The leading priests and teachers of religious law also mocked Jesus. He saved others, they scoffed, but he can't save himself. Let this Messiah, this King of Israel, come down from the cross so we can see it and believe him. Even the men who were crucified with Jesus ridiculed him.
Somebody say amen. Amen. I want y'all to understand that Jesus took on shame. He took on being belittled. He took on being embarrassed so that you don't have to carry it. So anybody in this room today that's carrying shame from your past, your present, your today, or even what you might do on tomorrow, I want you to know it's on the cross, baby. It was nailed over 2,000 years ago. So today we walk out of shame. We walk out of feeling belittled. We walk out of having low self-esteem and not valuing ourselves as the people of God. Amen? Let's go to John 11 and 25, verses through 38. When you there, say amen. Come on, y'all there? Amen.
Jesus told her, I am the resurrection and the life. Uh-huh. Anyone who believes in me will live even after dying. Everyone who lives in me and believes in me will never, ever die. Do you believe this, Martha? Yes, Lord, she told him. I have always believed you are the Messiah, the Son of God, the one who has come into the world from God. Then she returned to Mary. She called Mary aside from the mourners and told her, the teacher is here and wants to see you. So Mary immediately went to him. Jesus had stayed outside the village at the place where Martha met him.
Uh-huh.
When the people who were at the house consoling Mary saw her leave so hastily, they assumed she was going to Lazarus's grave to weep. So they followed her there. When Mary arrived and saw Jesus, she fell at his feet and said, Lord, if only you had been here, my brother would not have died.
Now, before he go any further, I want to tell you that there are some verses before this and there are some other accounts where Jesus had already told her that he was the resurrection. Amen? And that he was the truth. Amen? Because I want to point something out. Keep reading.
When Jesus saw her weeping and saw the other people wailing with her, a deep anger welled up within him, and he was deeply troubled. Where have you put him? He asked him.
And I want you to know when he said it, he didn't say it like, where you put him? It's in red. That means he kind of shouted it. Like, where is he? And when it's talking about Jesus was angry, I'm going to show you something. Keep reading.
Where have you put him? He asked them. They told him, Lord, come and see. Then Jesus wept.
Jesus did what?
Wept.
Keep reading.
The people who were standing nearby said, see how much he loved him? But some said, this man healed a blind man. Couldn't he have kept Lazarus from dying?
Running their mouth again.
Jesus was still angry as he arrived at the tomb, a cave with a stone rolled across its entrance.
Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Go back to verse 33. I want to take your attention. It said, when Jesus saw her weeping and saw the other people wailing with her, a deep anger welled up within him, meaning on the inside of him. Jesus got what? Somebody say mad.
Mad.
He was mad. He was upset. And he was deeply troubled. Where have you put him? He asked them. They told him, Lord, come and see. Then Jesus wept. Now, for years, I had been brought up and taught in church that Jesus was weeping because of the death of Lazarus. That ain't so. As I've been working and praying and walking at home and just asking God, give me some understanding of this weeping. Because the verse before tells me he was angry. After you read that he wept, it said even as he proceeded towards the tomb or to the tomb of Lazarus, he was still angry. So if he was angry before they told him, and then he was angry after they told him on the way to the tomb to raise Lazarus from the dead, is it possible that he wasn't crying because Lazarus was dead? Is it possible that he was crying because they had no faith? Some of these same people that was with Jesus had experienced the power of the resurrection, although he hadn't went to the cross. Y'all got it? Some of these same people had demons cast out, had family members healed, saw him raise people from the dead. They were in the procession when he stopped the funeral and just laid hands on the casket. And the boy rose up and came back. Some of these same people witnessed Jesus do miracles. And this was over a period of time. So to me, the Holy Ghost was saying, daughter, the reason I was angry, the reason I was upset within is because I've been walking with these people, showing them the power, showing them the glory, showing them the tenacity, showing them that I'm unstoppable, showing them that heaven is here and is invading earth. I've been walking with these people, trying to convince them that I am the Messiah, that I am the resurrection power, that I am, hallelujah. Hallelujah. God was angry and began to cry because the people still yet did not believe. Come on and give him praise. And God is saying to you today, don't be like these people in the Bible. Don't witness miracles. Don't come in here and see the power. Don't leave out of here with your healing and still don't believe. We still want to be skeptics. We still want to be skeptical. We still want to sit back and say, well, can a God I don't see do all that? Well, you breathing, can you see that? But if you breathe in and blow out, that was oxygen, and I couldn't see it. So it tells me that it had to be a God so bad, so awesome, that can put Zoe into the life of a man, and that can cause us to live, be formed in the womb of our mother, be knitted together with eyes, ears, nose, all the right parts. Have a brain, have understanding, come out as an infant, can't even take care of myself, grow up one day and be an adult like you and me, and you want to sit here and tell me you don't believe in the risen Christ? I come to tell somebody there is a God and his name is Jesus, and he is alive. Come on and shout, he is risen. Come on, say, he is risen. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's go to 1 Peter. I pray y'all being blessed. Are you being blessed? 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 3.
All praise to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. It is by his great mercy that we have been born again, because God raised Jesus Christ from the dead. Now we live with great expectation.
Now we live with what? New way I come to ask you, what are you expecting? What's your expectation today? How many of you believe that Jesus is I am? How many of you believe and know that he is Alpha and Omega? Let me give you some understanding of who I am is. God began to reveal to me and tell me who I am is. He said, I am he that protected you in your younger years when you was making foolish decisions. That's I am. He said, I am he who is protecting you in your present state while you still learning and growing and making dumb decisions. That's I am. He said, I'm still I am for your future, for tomorrow, for the mistakes and the dumb decisions you go make tomorrow. I'm still there. Although you haven't got there, you haven't arrived there, I'm already there waiting on you. So when you show up to make a mistake, I've already forgiven you. The blood has already covered because of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. I am that I am. I said, God, what is the I am? He said, I'm incomparable. He said, I'm omniscient. He said, I'm everywhere. He said, I'm the same place here, and I can be in California at the same time. He said, I can be in China and be in Newway at the same time. He said, I am. You can't measure me. You can't box me in. You can't stop me. You can't make me small, because I am God. Come on and give him praise. Come on and give him praise. And because of the cross, because of the resurrection, God sent me to tell somebody today that because he went to the cross, because he laid down his life, let me explain to you, the resurrection was never about Jesus. It was all about you. And because it was all about you, God told me to come down here at 29200 Shawasi and tell every believer that on the day of resurrection, right before he died, he spoke some words. And the Bible said, before he gave up the ghost, before he gave up his spirit, he said, it is finished. It is finished. It is finished. And I said, God, you know, I talk to God like this. You got to give me more in depth. I like the heavy stuff. I like break it down. What? I understand what was finished so I could tell the people. He said, well, let me give you another word instead of it's finished. He said, it's canceled. It's canceled. I said, what's canceled? Sickness and disease over the believer. Over the believer. Debt that you find yourself in, remember, he is I am from your past, your present, and your future. God said, it's finished. I'm canceling debt. Hallelujah. God said, I'm canceling divorce. Come on, somebody. God said, I'm canceling where the enemy has tried to destroy relationships. God said, I cancel the attack of Satan. God said, it's canceled. Hallelujah. God said, the spirit of suicide, I cancel it. Resurrection canceled the spirit. God said, anything that you're fighting with in your body, any financial difficulty, anything the enemy is trying to hinder or stop, every attack against your life, every plot against your life, every enemy, every demon that's been sent against your life, Jesus said on the day of resurrection, when I gave up the ghost, it was canceled. Come on, somebody, and scream, God, cancel it. God, cancel it.
I need you to go home and look at them and say, it was canceled. If there's anybody sick in your family, I need you to lay hands and say, it's canceled. In the name of Jesus. Any relationships that seem like they have dried up because of the work of the devil, I need you to begin to open your mouth and say, it's canceled. Come on and give him praise. Come on and give him praise. Come on and give him praise.
Yeah. Come back and I'm better. Yeah. I'm still alive cause he's so good. Every time I'm morning in the dance and I'm laughing, telling everybody that he's so